And I just, from a personal point of view, was, for us, it's an exciting time because our fire station, it's near completion, was built in 1873. We're opening up the George Peabody House on June 21st, where George Peabody was born in 1795. And we're moving the monument, by the way, for those who think it's leaving, it's not leaving, it's only being moved 22 feet. And I'm pleased to say that by June 21st, we're going to know a lot more about ourselves, our community, and we have three historic events happen. That is the restoring of the fire station, the finding of a tap capsule, and the opening of the George Peabody House. And when you see the inside of that, you'll be extremely impressed at how the professionals have captured the history of the city dating back to 1626 and ultimately the building of the home and the birth of George Peabody in 1795. Thing. Now, what else we're doing is we're also going to put together a new time capsule. Dave Wilson, who's a District 5 engineer from the State Department of Public Works, it's the project you see going on in the square is an urban assistance grant. It's 90% funded by the federal government, 10% funded by the state under the jurisdiction of Dave Wilson. We appreciate their cooperation in this whole process of finding the time capsule. And for those who have driven through Peabody Square for the last umpteen years, the lady sitting up top on the ball was sitting up there loose. Nothing holds that together but this shim underneath. There's no dowels, no rods. It just was sitting there. I'm not sure if they're going to put it back that way, but we went through a hurricane, Gloria, and a few other things. And it did say there was a piece of granite sitting on the time capsule and behind the corner of the piece behind the last piece of granite installed in the corner. This was found by the chief and Officer Brown, sitting, we assume, as it was placed there 150 years ago. So with that, I want to thank everybody that's been involved, representatives, district engineers, the police, the city council, everybody else who has worked to make this whole project happen. And out of not only having a better traffic pattern, a better aesthetically looking square, we're going to find out a little more about our history and the chief. As the boss, we'll bring it in. What we'll do is, if I may, what we're going to do is, we're going to allow everybody to see it. What we're going to do is, lay it out here. There'll be police protection, so nothing is missing. And we'll allow everybody to come by. Also, you're a historian, so you might be able to help us on that. And what we're going to do is ask everybody, once we have it all laid out in some sort of order, we would welcome you all to come by and see it. We're not sure exactly how we're going to deal with it. We're going to have to probably maybe do some things with the George Peabody House. We may try to do a display for the International Festival, but whatever is in there might be empty for all we know. What a disappointment.
That's the back of the North Shore, Massachusetts Bay, an illustration.
Illustrated Guide, Marblehead Salem, Cambridge, Beverly, Manchester by the Sea. They just changed it. Magnolia, Gloucester, and Rockford, and Ipswich. Dated 1881, 4th edition, Salem, Mass. We have. This is the Boston Daily Advertiser, Boston Friday morning, September 16, 1881, price 4 cents. These are Warren Bank bills for deposit in cornerstone of Soldiers' Monument.
James King to confer with post number 50 of the Grand Army of the Republic
regards to the matter and what report thereon at the adjournment. It's a whole report, I will read it, but basically there was the original report and ultimately building that monument. So why don't you put that in the middle. Also, it's a statement of accounts, town of Peabody for the year ending January 31st, 1881. Police budget 1881 appropriations $5,000. Office of fee received $328. Total budget $5,328. Let's see how far we've come as 3.8 written today. It has the whole report of the statement of accounts dating back to 1881. That's the name of all the town offices. Selectmen's assessors. Maybe Preston, Nathan H. Poor. You might recognize some of the names, these parks, playgrounds, and various other schools that are named after some of these people. Treasurer Nathan Poor, collector of taxes, Stevie Preston, overseers of Poor, George S. Sager, James P. King, James Fallon, fence viewer, John F. Pickering, John J. Walcott, Lewis Brown, Abraham Osborne, Bowman Files. Surveyors of Lumber. Charles G. Folsom, John Hackett, Edward Giddy, field drivers, constables, pound keepers, surveyors of highways, Board of Health, school committee. School committee in 1881, Daniel Elliott, Stephen Littlefield, Thomas Carroll, I assume the Carroll School's named after him, William Sperry for 2 years, John Hudson, Frank Farnham, I assume Farnham Park is named after him. It goes on and on. We have the annual report of the trustees of Peabody Institute Library, 1881. We have the committee for furnishing water at high service on January 17, 1881. They did some pretty nice reports in those days, really. We also have the school committee report, town of Peabody for the year ending April 1881. We have a lot of homework. We have here Warren Osborne, Esquire, Peabody, Mass. We have the Peabody Press, Charles Howard and Company, editors and publishers of the Peabody Press, Peabody, Mass, 1881. Warren Osborne. Dear sir, herewith letters of soldiers and sailors contributed by the town of Peabody in the suppression of the rebellion, and I will be it will be a favor to the press office if you will not allow it to go out of your hands until it is deposited in the lock. Respectfully yours, Charles Howard. I assume these are the names of all those sailors. That's the role, I guess. We're going to find out if anybody here, people in the community have ancestors that served in the Civil War. Formerly, soldiers and sailors credited to the town of Peabody, formerly South Danvers, during the rebellion of 1861 to 1865, enlisted. Jack Wells tells me there's 800. I guess it's a great project of some of our historians to skip the track now, some of the people who put that in. We have the role of the Union Post number 50, the Grand Army of Public for the books. This is comrades, in good standing of the Union Post 50, Department of Massachusetts Grand Army of the Republic, September 1st, 1881, listed are the names of those who were, belonged to Union Post 50, Civil War. It's devoted to local and general interests. Peabody, Mass. Saturday, September 10th, 1881. We have boys and girls. God wants the boys, the merry, merry boys, the noisy boys. I said, oh, okay. Helen Hyde's good deeds. Let's get to the advertising. St. James, it was. Hop Fitness. Groceries. P. Mahoney, dealer in groceries, provisions, vegetables, etc. Superior teas and coffees constantly on hand, the best brands of flour for sale, at the low prices, lowest prices. Mr. Mahoney is also prepared to furnish carriages at short notice. Weddings and funerals promptly attended. Walnut Street meeting. Salem Evening News dated Thursday evening, September 15th, 1881. And it's got the whole number of things. Polo game at the Willows tonight. The Boston police force is to be increased. Winslow and Rogers' head bookkeeper has gone on vacation. Officer McKenzie quieted a disturbance on Mason Street, Mason Hill at night, last night. North Street was thoroughly cleansed by the street sweeper yesterday. Nothing changes. Parsley and Stone's shop crew went on their annual fish fry yesterday. The coach office on Central Street being renovated with a paintbrush. Alley Bigelow and Weber, used to be Washburn also, always have the choicest novelties of the season. Mr. Irving Bessie, a PV reporter, made us a short visit yesterday. The ever popular actor Joseph Murphy appears in the Camp Hall tomorrow night. And on it goes. But that's still April 1881. This is September 16, 1881. This is a short excerpt from that handout we had about Garfield's death and the sensitivity of not having a big celebration for the dedicating a monument, so they had a very passive ceremony, and that was because of President Garfield's death. And this is the Boston Herald, and let me just give you an idea what it said. 1 month's bargain. We offer the coming week 1,000 gentlemen's all-wool vests, manufactured from remnants from our customs department, lot worth, not the garment, and the lot worth less than 250 for 75 cents. A line of gentlemen's all-wool suits, coats, vests, and pantaloons for $6 per suit. Men's ready-made all-wool pantaloons for $1.75. Fall-wool coats for $5. School suits for $3.50. Boys' all-wool suits for look at this and look what has just been done to it. You'll notice the siding is off. It's been restored to its original appearance of 1795. That's a picture of you. These photos by J.S. LeFevre, photo artist, Salem, Mass. We have another newspaper. And this one is the this is the Peabody Press, Peabody, Mass, Wednesday evening, September 14th, 1881. Let's make some interesting reading. This is the view of the city of Peabody. From Buxton Hill, 1877. Downtown? This is South Davis. Now came from Buxton Hill. Deposited by Evan King, lineal descendant of William and Hannah King, who landed in Salem in 1635. In the box it says Peabody, Mass. Duke D.A. and F.H. Caskin, ranges, cooking stoves, brick and portable hot air furnaces, plumbing and all kinds of rubber, hose and couplings, water attachments for stoves, number 13 holes. That's what the courthouse is.